is a place fit only for war. Thousands of square miles are nothing but sand and stone. A compass is as necessary, once off the road, as it is to a sailor at sea. Water doesn't exist until you bore deep into the earth. You bath in your shaving mug. Flies have the tenacity of bulldogs. Bruises readily turn to desert sores. Days that are very hot can be followed by nights of bitter cold. When the hot Khamsin wind brings its sandstorms, life can be intolerable. The Arabs say that after 5 days of it, murder can be excused. The tide of this war in the desert has ebbed and flowed, but as Rommel advanced after we lost Tobruk, never had our backs been so close to the Suez Wall. We had lost 80,000 men and much booty. He was deliberately falling back on El Alamein, no more than 60 miles from Alexandria. To Rommel, advancing at considerable speed, Egypt, with the Nile Delta which gives it life, Cairo, British General Headquarters and Africa's principal city, Alexandria, Egypt's chief port and base of our Mediterranean fleet, and Suez, gateway to the Far East, all these must have seemed dazzlingly near as a mirror, and as it proved, as much an illusion. It was a wise decision of General Auchinlech to come back to El Alamein, much the strongest natural line of defense between the Libyan frontier and the Delta. Moreover, Rommel's lines of supply were here stretched to the limit. On the right, our flank rested on the sea. On the left, it approached the Qattara Depression, a trough the size of Wales, one third of it salt marsh, and all of it territory that no vehicle can cross. On this 40 miles front, General Auchinlech took personal command. His the total responsibility. Not another yard back were we going. His much depleted army dug, blasted, and wired itself in, and laid protective mines. Our front was one of discontinuous belts of minefields with strong points, and machine gun and anti-tank gun emplacements. But it was as yet extremely slender. Here, General Auchinlech waited. And with him, men who had fought at Gazala in Sidi Rezegh. Others who had been twice to Benghazi. Others who had escaped from Bir Hakim and Tobruk. The 8th Army had made a fighting retreat of 400 miles. And the battle which approached in its importance, the Battle of Britain, was now at hand. The Middle East, Suez, and infinitely more was at stake. The crucial days had come. After several days of attack and counterattack, the British, Australians, Indians, and South Africans were still there, fighting as dogged as our infantry at Waterloo. The immediate crisis was past, but anxiety remained. Situation stepped Mr. Churchill, bringing his own inspiration and vigor. He brought good news of reinforcements both in men and supplies which had already rounded the Cape. For 5 days he visited the Army and Air Force, explaining the task and its importance. And most dramatic of all, he brought new commanders, General Alexander and General Montgomery. Alexander, one of the last men out of Dunkirk, and whose small army withstood the Japanese the whole length of Burma, and Montgomery, who took over the 8th Army. A man who lives as sternly as a Cromwell, and who is as much a part of his modern Ironsides. Battles swallow up weapons faster than you can build them. At home in Britain, the machinery of war poured from the factories. And British women worked alongside men on the shells, the ships, the tanks, the aircraft, the explosives. In no country are women so thoroughly organized for war. Among them,